McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Hustlers and Seekers, How to Crush It and Find Fulfillment Without Losing Your Mind by Tommy Baker. Narrated by Tommy Baker. Introduction. You're torn between two worlds. In one world, there's the constant push towards doing more, tackling massive ambitions, and chasing your dreams at 100 miles an hour. You need to be a grinder, a high performer, a go-getter. You must take relentless action. Grind, baby, grind. In this world, you're a ruthless achiever. You must wake up at 4:30 a.m., dominate your morning, and complete an 11-step ritual before sunrise. You can't ever take your foot off the gas. Otherwise, you're going to lose and succumb to a life of toil, averageness, and incessant mediocrity. That's the fear, right? You'll be left behind, forgotten, as good as dead, a goner. In the other world, detaching, creating space, and unplugging are crucial. This world is where you pause, meditate, align with your North Star. You must practice mindfulness and be aware. You must surrender and be here now, allowing the right doors to open through divine timing. Otherwise, you'll be left in the fetal position from burnout, spit into the abyss of ambition. That's what they say, right? You need to unplug, detach, breathe. Some days you feel a fire hose of motivation flowing through your veins, blasting the latest Gary Vee video during your morning commute, dripping with the high-octane energy required to propel you through a 14-hour day. But on others, you want to retreat into the cave and triple down on self-care. You desire to spend your day in complete nothingness with an Abraham Hicks monologue reverberating in the background, contemplating the meaning of existence. Namaste, bitches. On the surface, these worlds seem entirely dissimilar. On one hand, you have the nose-to-the-grindstone, nitro-cold-brew-chugging lifestyle we'll call hustle, defined as the work ethic to fuel your boldest ambitions, or doing. On the other hand, you have the Eckhart Tolle be-here-now state of seeking, defined as the rituals and practices to create space, or being. Like whiskey and kombucha, these two worlds couldn't be more different, right? The promises you're told and often believe go something like this. If you hustle hard and long enough, one day you'll have the full bank accounts and freedom to do the things you love, go on adventures you crave, have the experiences you've dreamed of, waking up in an oasis where your most painstaking decision is choosing between pina coladas and margaritas on a sun-soaked paradise, or if you create enough space and seeking in your life, then one day you'll feel fulfilled inside, void of all attachments to the outer world, reaching a zen-like state of nirvana the Buddha himself would be proud of, where life is a cascading flow of grace and ease as you rise above the need to create achievement, soaking in meditative, orgasmic bliss. Pick one, but you cannot have both. Because the moment you pick hustle, you're choosing to be obsessed. Anything less is sheer laziness. You're simply another talker who doesn't want it bad enough. Say goodbye to long weekends, self-care, and some much-needed you time. In the trenches of ambition, the price of admission is your every waking hour. Sleep when you're dead isn't a cliche, it's a life manifesto. Hashtag committed. When you pick seeking, you're opting out of the rat race, the material-obsessed hedonic treadmill to nowhere. You connect to universal truths, become a samurai of your emotions. You step away from the noise that tells you to work harder, turn your hobby into a side hustle, and quit your 9-to-5. You've got a one-way ticket to enlightenment. Woke AF. But you can't have both because kale and concrete don't go down easy with your morning smoothie. Because of this, you find yourself in a constant tug of war between doing and being, action and allowing, discipline and freedom, structure and surrender, intensity and nothingness, constraints and creativity, priorities and playfulness, rigidness and novelty, on time and off time, hustling and seeking. To address this, you read a book on audacious goal setting and then one on letting go. You listen to a podcast on focus and then one on surrender. You walk down the aisles of your actual or virtual bookstore and glance at one side of the shelves, crushing it, how to squeeze out every minute of the workday and way too many books with expletives in their title. Thank you, Mark Manson. Can we end this fucking trend like yesterday? But then you glance at the opposite shelf and notice a completely different array of titles. Self-care, unplugging, how the universe has your back, why anything except the present moment is an illusion, and why the secret is your path to the Porsche you so desire. When you attempt to reconcile these worlds, you're left in a far-off, hazy land we'll refer to as the messy middle. In this place, clarity, knowing who you are, what you want, and what you're about is a pipe dream as you slumber through your weeks, months, and years in a fog-like haze. Stuck between two worlds, you do nothing. In the messy middle, indecision thrives. Overthinking becomes your modus operandi. Fear of missing out, or FOMO, is the new baseline. Guilt starts to take up the prized real estate inside of your head, rent-free. It brings overwhelm along for the ride. They're both freeloaders that suck up every ounce of your emotional energy. Sprinkle in an ample dose of distraction, and you've got a recipe for plummeting fulfillment and performance. In the valley of the messy middle, there never seems to be enough time, energy, or money to achieve or enjoy your goals. Consistency is a pipe dream, and momentum starts, stops, starts. Ideas, insights, and breakthroughs sound amazing, but never become real. You know how to live an optimized life, but it seems to escape you. You yearn for progress and much more you time. Ultimately, the messy middle is a void where emotional freedom, your ability to feel enduring states of peace, never lasts. Instead, you're simply trying to slog through the day. But when did this become the standard? If what I'm describing resonates on any level, don't fret. Understand you aren't at fault here. To desire and work towards a fuller life is courageous. But with clashing messages and an endless stream of content, tips, and hacks from both sides, this life can seem to escape you. I've been there. It is perfectly normal to feel overwhelmed. It's why you picked up this book. It is why I wrote it. There is a better way. In this place, you're able to tap into both ends of a life well-lived. This includes achievement, making progress on your goals, and fulfillment, feeling engaged, alive, and present. You're able to extract the benefits of each side, momentum and results, plus peace and clarity. In this place, you make a dent on what matters while having plenty of you time left over. Before we get there, you may find yourself thinking, who is this guy making these bold promises? This book was born out of self-preservation. I've been torn between these worlds. I've been the sucker who was sold the faux promises of both and had to immerse myself in each one to find out the capital T truth. In other words, I've done the dirty work for you. I indoctrinated myself as a proud fist-in-the-air hustler. I climbed the corporate ladder at a blistering pace and then took the hustler's classic plunge into starting my business. We built a staff of 12. I'd start the day at 4:30 a.m. and finish late into the night, fueled by ambition. I could not stop. I took 0 days off. Tommy, people don't work on 4th of July or Christmas Eve, was a routine conversation with my staff. Really? I found that hard to believe as I stared at a Crusher competition quote on the wall. All of this technically worked, but not if that means, you know, having any semblance of a real life. My social life was relegated to Netflix and chill dates with my bulldog. He's a looker, but he snores and drools too. Worst of all, I didn't know who I was when I wasn't plugged in. A hot date? Yeah, no, I didn't go on one for an entire year. Balance? That's not in my vocabulary. Disconnecting, fun, and play? Get the hell out of here. Due to this, I barely recognized my own successes. Every time I achieved a goal, I'd move the goalpost back. The high never lasted. It was never enough, which meant I was never enough. Damn it. I searched for answers. There had to be a better way. I found seeking. I unplugged into the void, embarking on a quest of epic proportions. I went to week-long Buddhist retreats, became a yogi, started the day reading the Gita. I spent hundreds of hours in a sensory deprivation tank. I hung with gurus, monks, and sages. This pursuit created obscene amounts of peace and allowed me to sit in the lotus position, oh hey, hips, for hours. But it also left me indifferent to goals and detached to the point of apathy. It led me to count every last penny and argue on the phone with Bank of America on why my account was overdrawn for the 7th time. Those $35 charges really start to add up. Clearly, this wasn't working either. Stubborn to the bone, I dug my heels in deeper. I found myself in nondescript shopping malls in Salt Lake City to train with those who built the Adonis-like bodies of the movie 300. I spent a week on a vision quest searching for my life's purpose. I joined a men's transformation group resembling Fight Club, black eyes and torn ACLs included. I was dumped in the Pacific Ocean blindfolded. I stared into people's eyes for 40 minutes, so far past the point of discomfort we both had crusted tears on our faces. I visited random cabins in the woods for emotional work. I spent time with mystics, healers, and shamans. If there was even a scant hope of transformation, I was all in. As time passed, I became troubled. I noticed there was a prevailing disconnect. I'd meet uber-successful business owners who hated their home life. I met gifted creatives who lived a degenerate lifestyle mirroring Bukowski. I'd noticed the spiritual community shunned talking about money, progress, and results. I'd meet people who had achieved their dreams 10 times over but desperately needed more. I'd engage with those bursting at the seams with fulfillment but knowing they weren't infusing their real lives with it. Something was missing. What I'd realized is these people were living as hustlers or seekers. They'd planted a flag in one world that came with a prevailing narrative, a set of beliefs that may have been working to the outside world, but how are we defining working? Conventional hustling and seeking both reach a point of diminishing return when spending more time and energy in one world not only lessens the benefit one receives, but starts doing more harm than good. Hustlers add more work and intensity, shifting into overdrive only to experience anxiety, stress, and a one-way ticket to burnout USA. Seekers add more space, self-care, and insight gathering, only to tip the scales of detachment and be bursting with wisdom, but zero tangible results. No thanks. Is this working? A glance at our culture's busyness trap, plummeting engagement, and increased burnout makes it clear. It's not. 69% of workers are disengaged, and 2/3 of employees have dealt with burnout. Entrepreneurs are worse off. According to the National Institute of Mental Health, 72% are affected by mental health issues compared to 48% for non-entrepreneurs. On the flip side, Americans write a collective check to the tune of $14 billion for personal growth, mindfulness, and spiritual guidance every year. Consciousness is now mainstream and a mainstay in people's budgets. And yet, we've never been more anxious, neurotic, and overwhelmed as anxiety affects 40 million adults in America alone. There has to be a better way. Instead of continuing to slam the accelerator in one direction or the other, these sides must coalesce. By coming together, they create a radical shift in perspective. They infuse each other with precisely what going past the point of diminishing returns cannot. In other words, the right hustle can amplify seeking. The right seeking can amplify hustling. In this place, the messy middle is replaced with a sweet spot where you can extract the best of both worlds. Imagine a Venn diagram with hustling on the left and seeking on the right. On the left, hustling, there's things like ambition, declaration, relentless action, decisiveness, focus, constraint, compete, urgency, mentorship, leaving your comfort zone, priorities, grit, showing up, building identity, and structure. On the right, seeking, we have alignment, passing tests, celebration, intuition, perspective, creativity, detachment, divine timing, becoming your own guru, recovering, white space, gratitude, being unavailable, slaying the ego, and creating novelty. In the middle, you create your own sweet spot. Once I removed the jargon that tells from each world, it hit me like a splash of ice water to the face. Both sides want the same things. The quest and application of high performance and mindfulness are the same. Stripped naked to their core, at their most essential, they're vying for what we all crave, including progress, meaning, peak states, performance, confidence, connection, freedom, emotional sanity, awe, wonder, and bliss. Once the cute social media quotes, Sanskrit tattoos, and fist-bumping mannerisms are eliminated, we recognize the truth. Both sides are on the same highway with one clear destination: growth. Both desire the thrill of heart-thumping progress. Both have an endgame to feel alive. Both are trying to find themselves, create meaning, and connect to something palpable. Ultimately, both want freedom from the past, their upbringing, the shackles of limitation. These worlds aren't contradictory opposites at all. They're complementary. It is their approach, the how, that differs. At their most essential, they're equals. And what's missing in their quest isn't more of the same. They need something else. They need each other. They require contrast, the ability to gather insights and perspective from an unfamiliar place. Desperately. Here's the rub. Both sides miss out if they're unable to integrate each other. By having a compass in the future we're aiming for, we're able to be more present today. And by being more present, we're able to not miss here for there, which oddly enough increases our chances of getting there. That was a mouthful, so I hope you're still with me. The mindsets and strategies from hustle expand your spiritual or being life. The right practices and commitment to seeking boost one's performance, creativity, and doing in professional life. Not only can these two worlds coexist, but they must. Each one fuels the other and increases critical markers of a life well lived. The fulfillment that comes with self-worth and the gratitude of doing what we're meant to, plus the freedom that arises with achievement. This includes more zeros in your bank account and success in life, career, and business. Isn't that what we're here for? Whiplashed by this paradoxical sweet spot, I discovered everything had shifted. I noticed others who'd merged these worlds. It was evident they were incredibly high performers, yet grounded. They were living a life of a warrior and a sage, a doer and a beer, driven but soulful, ambitious yet humble, obsessive at times while having the time of their lives. They were able to show up and perform like no other, but then shut it off. They weren't hustlers or seekers, they were hustlers and seekers. With years of practice, integrating, and fine-tuning, I merged both. I could take action and then allow the mystery of life to unfold. I could be disciplined in the pursuit and then surrender to the moment. I could practice grit and then experience a level of gratitude that brought me to my knees. I'd obsessively tackle my vision, then I'd unplug so as to be asked about it and say, what vision? I was performing at an otherworldly rate, but instead of needing more, I never felt more at peace. This was the state I'd been longing for, yet it had felt so elusive to the point of feeling impossible. But this isn't about me, it's about you. Like a mad scientist, I was the guinea pig to test these principles. Those who followed me were on deck. I launched a platform with a successful podcast, the Resist Average Academy, coaching platform, and live events. I tested the principles and helped others who wanted to merge both worlds, but like the earlier version of myself, had no clue how. I served clients from all over. They'd fly cross-country to learn how they could do the same. They too wanted the best of both worlds, to achieve their wildest dreams, but to do so feeling whole, complete, grounded. I spent nearly 1,000 hours in the trenches having engaging conversations with the world's best on the Resist Average Academy podcast. Millions of downloads, thousands of direct coaching hours, and several events later, I realized the wisdom had been screaming at all of us with the answers. But I'd been so caught up in the messy middle that I couldn't hear those answers. The reality is that we all have an inner hustler, the part of ourselves that desires to bring an audacious dream to life. We also have an inner seeker, the part of us that yearns for a deeper, more meaningful existence. When we deny either part of ourselves, we lose. And so does everyone else. When we honor both part of ourselves, we show up like never before, grow at exponential rates, lift others up, and win. And by winning, I mean we're able to feel peace, freedom, and meaning, plus bring goals to life with rewards, including access, options, and bank deposits. In other words, we can have the best of both worlds. To perform at the top of one's game, but not be defined by it. To bring together achievement and fulfillment. To feel whole, connected, and integrated, to feel a sense of progress, richness, and aliveness in our day-to-day, to merge doing and being. Since you picked up this book, I'll take a wild guess this is what you want as well. But up to this point, you've been unable to bring it to life, and that's fine because you're where you need to be. Let's dive into the roadmap of how we'll get you there. How to read this book. This book uses the principles, mindsets, and tactics that have helped countless transcend the messy middle that has become society's status quo. I get that your idea of a wild Saturday night has nothing to do with Google Scholar and a cold glass of kombucha, getting high off academia and mystical legends. I'm the nerd here, so let's get that out of the way. With that in mind, I've written this to be digestible, engaging, and fun. Beyond the surface, there is a reservoir of research and ideologies. These include humanistic psychology, neuroscience, and studies on happiness. I coupled these with studies on performance, goal setting, fulfillment, mysticism, flow states, mindfulness, and philosophy. I borrow from pioneers who recognize the threat of performance and spirituality, athletic feats, and mysticism. These include psychologists William James, Abraham Maslow, Carl Rogers, and Viktor Frankl, as well as current thought leaders such as Ken Wilber, Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi, and Stephen Kotler. I pair this with candid conversations with high performers and lifelong seekers who are honest about their struggles and academics who study this work for a living. This book helps you coalesce both states of being and doing to arrive at a new sweet spot, to get you thinking, feeling, and acting in a way where you can reap the rewards. Ultimately, the goal is to help you integrate these two worlds from your life's macro big picture down to your day-to-day. Let's examine how we're going to get you there. In part one, we'll dive headfirst into both hustling and seeking, sifting through why they are incredibly powerful until they're not. We'll reveal the myths that keep people stuck and on the wrong side of diminishing returns. We'll strip away the noise that anything less than a 12-hour day means you're lazy and why seeking, despite its endless praise, has a dark side. We'll tackle the biggest myth of them all, that you must pick one or the other or else. You'll recognize you can replace the or with and. Part one sets the foundation. In part two, we'll showcase 16 chapters to put this into practice by merging one principle from each side. You'll learn hustle principles as a spiritual practice and spiritual practices as performance amplifiers. Each is deconstructed, stripped to its marrow, the best of what it has to offer. We'll explore the perils of too much of each and how to know when you've hit that point. While each chapter can be read independently, they are best digested whole. A note of caution, this is not about equal balance. In some periods of life and business, you may hustle 80% of the time and seek 20% of the time. In others, you may flip this entirely by seeking 70% of the time and hustling 30%. Part of the book's process is helping you identify what you need and dosing appropriately. What matters is you understand both are required at all times to some degree if you want to maximize growth, progress, results, and emotional freedom, no matter who you are. Armed with a new perspective, you're going to experience countless benefits from this potent blend. Say hello to your new sweet spot. Along the way, you'll be accessing what renowned psychologist Maslow called peak states. You'll tap into what Csikszentmihalyi, no, don't even try to say it, deemed flow, those timeless, present moments in life that we never want to end. When both worlds come together, you self-actualize. Contrary to popular belief, none of this is a selfish pursuit. When you and I live rich, meaningful lives with resources to match, we take the focus off ourselves. We are less self-absorbed, less neurotic. The pursuit of your best self is not selfish at all. It's selflessness. When we hit the sweet spot of performance and fulfillment, we enter a state of thriving. We lift others, we give more. We contribute to the tapestry of our communities. We are more compassionate, kind, and connected. As Maslow, who coined the term self-actualization, said, it is empirical fact that self-actualizing people are altruistic. With this in mind, you're able to tap into the potential you've neglected. You'll experience a level of creativity you've dreamed of, and best of all, an inner, humble confidence of knowing where you need to be right now. Nothing is missing, and there is nothing to prove. True freedom. These are bold promises, I know, but you arrived at this material for a reason. It is my responsibility to follow through. To do so, you'll need to meet me halfway. You'll need to be open to a new path. Some of your deeply held beliefs about work, results, and fulfillment will be questioned. Whether you've identified as a fist-pumping, defiant hustler, an unquenchable seeker, or a scrappy mix who flip-flops from one side to the other with inconsistent results, I'm asking you to consider a new approach. Don't worry, you'll still get your fill from each side. And the work you'll do by tapping into the other world will only amplify the benefits you're receiving. As a side note, I use a few words heavily through the text, which I'll define quickly so we're on the same page. Ego refers to the part of us that desperately wants to be approved of and seen in the best light at all times, even when it doesn't make sense. Clarity refers to knowing who we are, what matters to us, and where we're going with our lives from the big picture to a random Tuesday. Alignment is consistency among thoughts, words, actions, values, and the decisions we make. Achievement is our ability to perform, create results, and bring our goals to life consistently. Fulfillment is a deep state of peace that is accessed through meaning, purpose, and being excited about our lives. Overwhelm is that incessant feeling that we're doing the wrong things with our lives and we're constantly falling behind. Emotional freedom refers to states where we are at peace with ourselves and free of the narrative that we're off course, flawed, or beholden to the past. It's time to bring these two communities and ways of living, doing, and being together to finally let your inner hustler out of the cage and onto the field of play and your inner seeker to roam free. It's time to stop beating yourself up, free yourself from FOMO, and optimize these parts of who you are. It's time to escape the messy middle before it leaves you naked in the fetal position, tied to a cactus in Vegas, wondering how the hell you got there. That's a story for another time. It's about time the hustlers and the seekers all threw a giant party and got along, and I want you to be in the middle of it. For a free audio masterclass and toolkit to help you integrate this material as you listen, visit www.resistaverageacademy.com/hustlers-seekers. Part 1. The Dilemma. It's time to dive into the specifics of both hustling and seeking and their respective downsides so you'll know when you're approaching the place where more is not more. Here, you'll discover the mindsets, strategies, tactics, and language from hustling and seeking that work until they start doing more harm than good. You'll recognize why both sides not only should coexist, but are meant to. Best of all, you'll release the myths that hold each side hostage with surprising consequences. Armed with this crucial insight, you'll identify the places where you're doing it right and where you have opportunities for rapid growth. Part 1 will set you up for success with Part 2's principles so you can develop a new sweet spot. Let's get this show on the road, shall we? Chapter 1. Hustle, Hustle, Burnout. Hustle, the unrelenting pursuit of achievement and win-at-all-cost ethos, is embedded into the American psyche so deep that it may as well drip red, white, and blue. In a world where we value external rewards above everything else, it's no surprise hustle is intoxicating. We must always have more, do more, achieve more. But we also must ask ourselves, is it working? When I use the word working, I'm asking if hustle itself leads to a fulfilling, thriving life from the inside out. One where we can be at peace, content, and proud of ourselves. A life where we feel alive and emotionally free. To answer this question, let's turn to the annals of high achievement, the National Football League. No country is more obsessed with competitive sport than America. We pedestal athletes, kids plaster posters of their favorite stars on bedroom walls, parents pop a blood vessel as they shout from the sidelines of their child's travel games. And that child is 8 years old. This obsession is defined by the NFL's soaring popularity and the cruel reality that for an athlete to even make a team sounds like a miracle. At any given time, there are about 2,000 active players. In a country with 327 million people, that represents 0.00061039.7% of the population. You can't get much closer to zero. The coveted crown in this world is none other than the pinnacle of sport, the elusive Vince Lombardi Trophy, granted to one champion every year who endures the torment of training camp, the 17-week season, and a winner-take-all playoff. Winning isn't elite, it's elite to the 34th square. Naturally, you'd think for an athlete who has reached this pinnacle after hustling and enduring the agony of grueling practices, roster cuts, injuries, and a 24/7 obsession with performance since turning 7 years old, this would indisputably be the greatest moment of that athlete's life. The apex of everything and anything they've ever wanted, and then some. But for Aaron Rodgers, the MVP-winning quarterback of the Green Bay Packers, it wasn't. Only hours after the clock struck double zeros and the Packers were crowned 2010 Super Bowl champions, Rodgers sat on a team bus surrounded by the rousing energy of dozens of childhood dreams coming to life and enough champagne to kill a horse. But something was missing. As the alpha hustler, Rodgers has a rare combination of talent, skill, and lethal desire to prove the naysayers wrong. Driven by an underlying current that came from being a top 5 draft pick hopeful to an agonizing public slide to the 25th pick in the 2005 draft, he kept a scoreboard. Oh, did he ever. As cameras panned at his dejected look on draft evening, an inner fire destined to last decades was brewing. all the people who'd wronged him, passed on him, or critiqued his player attitude. General managers, journalists, his own coach, and even friends and families drove him to sheer excellence. Rogers expanded on this high-octane fuel in a 2007 interview with ESPN the magazine, saying, "That was what fueled me, to wake up at 5 o'clock and work out before school and stay after and do extra sets and do extra throwing. The root of that was to be great, to prove a point every single day." Winning would be his cure-all, the ultimate "I showed you" moment. Kiss the ring, baby. With a trophy in hand, he'd have his arrival moment, the one he dreamed of and wanted more than anything in the world. He'd finally be free, right? Sitting on the bus that evening with the cumulative energy from all those years, the reps, early mornings, hours of meticulous film study, public slights, the sports media talking heads, winning didn't offer him the respite he'd imagined. According to ESPN, he didn't feel like he had risen to a higher plane. Rather, he realized he was still looking for something, for a sense of clarity or purpose that was beyond his current line of sight. "I hope I don't just do this," Rogers thought to himself. This is what came to mind as he reflected amidst the tears, partying, his teammates scooping up VIP tables at clubs, reveling on the incredible win. Rogers' sinking realization that hustle alone is not enough is common. Why? Because hustle alone does not give you peace. It doesn't provide lasting emotional freedom. It doesn't always deepen purpose or contribute to meaning. As Rogers said months after his moment, "I've been to the bottom and I've been to the top, and peace will come from somewhere else." While winning had checked off every marker of hustler's golden child through boundless achievement, it hadn't filled the void of fulfillment, the confluence of meaning, peace, and emotional freedom we all crave. While hustle is oh so effective at filling up the bucket of achievement past the brim, it rarely pours over to the other bucket of a life well lived, the inner game of fulfillment. And hence the hustler's dilemma. Relying on achievement alone is not a strategy for success, unless one wants to arrive at the mountaintop and recognize, like Rogers, that a void still exists. And because this pursuit typically entails years of sacrifice with the expectation that the arrival moment will be the ultimate cure-all, the results can be devastating. But we've heard this before. Rogers' story is all too common. The rags-to-riches tale we hear on a podcast leading to an existential crisis, the celebrity who has a drug-induced breakdown, the author who sold millions of copies and became depressed after attaining everything he or she ever wanted. We collectively yawn at these tales, muttering under our breath some variation of "must be nice," as we stubbornly believe we'll be the exception to the rule as long as we have our Jerry Maguire "show me the money" moment too. I'm raising my hand. I've lit myself on fire with the jet fuel of ambition and with a staunch belief that when I got there, I'd be free too. All the fear, worry, and doubt would melt away. And for some reason, if that wasn't the case, all I had to do was pull myself up by my bootstraps and conquer the next mountain. Does this sound familiar? But like Rogers, I realized I wasn't the exception, and neither are you. To fully grasp the hustler's dilemma, we first must examine the oh-so-intoxicating energy that draws us into her world with a seductive allure. Why we love hustle. Hustle is easy to love. It's attractive, at times irresistible, and when taken too far, it can be deceptively addictive as the lines between a healthy pursuit and a full-blown obsession are blurred. Why? First, hustle is typically yours, and we all love autonomy in our lives and careers. Autonomy, simply defined, is the freedom needed to direct your own life, work, and growth. It is your hustle, your side hustle, your dream. Hustle acts as an alluring bridge to our external desire, including cash in the bank, applause, letters after our name, and doors opening that otherwise are sealed shut. It allows us to prove others wrong, including our own inner critic, and it leads to winning. Lots of winning. Second, hustle satiates a core human motivator, progress. Research by Harvard professor Therese Amabil and psychologist Stephen Kramer studied what makes humans at work tick, why they stay motivated or fizzle out. In analyzing 12,000 diary entries of workers' emotions, they came to one conclusion. It's not money. It's not security. It's not approval. It's progress. Progress is more important than anything else. The world of hustle is soaking wet with progress. It allows you to cross off 9 items from your to-do list and make a dent on your vision. It compels you to rise before sunrise and crush the high-intensity fitness session. It pushes you to polish up the resume and make the bold pitch to the recruiter. Progress fuels our sense of self, builds self-esteem, and gives us an identity in the world. Check, check, check. Pour me a double. Third, we are engulfed in a culture of getting shit done, or GSD. We obsess over productivity hacks. We squeeze every second of the workday. The modern world places immense value on accomplishment, achievement, and accolades. When we check off those boxes, we feel like we're part of the tribe. We feel worthy. Whether we're at the local cocktail mixer or our LinkedIn profiles are being perused, we feel a sense of pride when we're asked what we're working on or how snazzy our bio reads. The pull of hustle gets us from all angles. On the surface, hustle seems to check all the boxes. It seems to give a healthy return on investment, or ROI. When you input effort, you get back growth, self-esteem, progress, performance, pings of bank account deposits, and the brand new apartment with that oh-so-perfect view. What's not to like? Well, for starters, a core part of hustle comes from an insatiable desire for external approval. I'll refer to this as the dark side of hustle, and it's not necessarily bad. Rather, it is hardwired into our DNA. It must be understood and acknowledged to be dealt with appropriately. Otherwise, it can spit us into an existential abyss where we question everything. How hustle really drives us. To grasp hustle's undeniable power, we first must understand one of its drivers of motivation, the desire to make it. Making it can be defined in myriad ways, and it acts as a palpable part of any endeavor, outcome, or goal. Making it, of course, is entirely subjective. We tend to have a fuzzy image in our minds of what it looks and feels like. It's the six-figure salary or the corner office. It's the book deal, a star role, a check from the investor, meeting our soulmates, or a mishmash of all of these as we're fielding calls from media, fans, and followers. It's the little blue checkmark after our name. The desire to get there gets us up in the morning to do focused work. It keeps us awake to finish the paper. It gets us to do what marketing expert Seth Godin calls shipping, hitting publish, sharing your work, displaying your art, even when no one cares and few people, except grandma, because she's awesome, are paying attention. This fire to make it burns deep inside, alchemized as high-octane fuel for you to execute. But this motivation doesn't always come from a wholesome place. It can lead us to achieve for the lone sake of external praise, awards, and accolades at the expense of our authentic desire. Crazy, huh? Take law school, an endeavor roughly 130,000 students experience at any moment. This is a generalization, but many of these students have minimal desire to be attorneys. Many simply enroll because they didn't know what else to do and everybody else seemed to be doing it. They embark on the path for its superficial benefits. The freshly minted six-figure salary and the turning of heads at the summer barbecue when asked what they're doing after college. Parents vicariously live through their children, proudly displaying Yale Law bumper stickers as their kids fantasize passing the bar exam and having an Esquire at the end of their name. External, external, external. But it doesn't come without a hefty cost. In fact, a study revealed that an estimated 30,000 to 60,000 law students struggle with depression at some point during their tenure, nearly 4 times above the general population. Let's face it, to enroll, endure, and finish law school requires hustle. To pass the bar exam requires hustle. To be recruited to a firm and slog away those years of paying one's dues requires hustle. To reach the promised land of partner, the oasis at the pinnacle of one's law career where the average age of such accomplishment is 52 years old requires, well, you know the answer. But to what end? Now, if you're reading this and have a desire to be a real-life Atticus Finch, own it. The point can be made in any career, including mine. I was on a fast track to Wall Street despite having a moral aversion to the industry, being a joke with my own finances, and setting the all-time record for overdrafts in a day, according to Carl from Bank of America. The record was 11, in case you're wondering. Hustle, then, can become a trap of stoking our ambition through desperate, needy approval. It can lead to trading our mental sanity for years, no, decades of hard work in order to be congratulated and look up to at the expense of ourselves. While the endgame can be a trophy case of outer rewards, we feel empty. We get there only to realize we are hollow and apathetic. Sure, we ticked off the boxes and everyone's impressed, but so what? Dr. Risa Stein, professor of psychology at Rockhurst University, expands on this point, saying, "If our life plans or even just short-term goals are guided by external criteria without a true understanding of what it is that we actually want or what fulfills us and satisfies us, then we end up at a minimum disconcerted and unhappy, and at worst with a midlife crisis or severely depressed." Which leads us to the dark side of hustle. The dark side of hustle. The dark side of hustle can lead us to pursue success from self-loathing and hatred, to prove others wrong, or to fill a void inside caused by past trauma. We all have some variation of these egoic needs. It's part of the human experience. But since hustle soothes this pain, it can become our identity. If we don't address it, our ambitions can turn into a lifelong vendetta against faux haters, trolls, and critics. To be clear, not all hustle comes from this dark place. Part of it comes from a healthy pursuit of a vision that fuels you from the inside, a clear purpose and desire to impact and serve. I'll explore this in each of the principles to extract the best of what it has to offer. The problem arises when we tip the scales and the attractive side of hustle turns sour. This manifests in putting in another hour when you're tapped out as your mental sanity suffers. It's checking your email for the 88th time during your commute. It's being on date night with family and unconsciously checking business metrics like a zombie who can't help but scroll. It can lead to frayed relationships, a rabbit hole of comparison, and becoming a workaholic to feel worthy. What was once useful can turn into a full-blown, unstoppable addiction. Since achievement alone doesn't lead to fulfillment, the rabbit hole only gets deeper the further we go. This is the inexplicable pull of external reward, the fact that it can lead us to create a life we never wanted in the first place, or we obliterate our psyche, sanity, and relationships on the way to the mountaintop, or both. Addictions, by definition, make us blind. Consider the recent college admission scandal in which parents were charged with bribing schools with buckets of cash to get their kids in. This is not normal behavior. It is an obsession gone haywire, where already privileged families took illegal action to fulfill the void. Or the infamous fire festival, where belief turned into delusion and delusion to negligence when a supposed luxury music festival became a scam destined for folklore, where luxury accommodations were disaster relief tents and a, quote, uniquely authentic island cuisine experience became a trending cheese sandwich. These are not random occurrences. When we're drunk on external approval, we can't see clearly. Blitzed by ambition, we can't tell north from south or east from west. We make bad decisions. We lose ourselves and sometimes the people we love. We wake up and wonder where it all went wrong. To ensure you don't slide into the abyss of addictive hustle, you'll need to understand the law of diminishing hustle. In other words, you'll need to know when more is not more. The law of diminishing hustle. You're doing work that matters, moving the needle, and reaping the benefits of forward progress. You're taking action and staying committed. All good things, right? However, move farther along this curve and you'll wind up hitting the point of diminishing returns, where more is not more. This breaking point is where your ability to add an input of time, energy, or effort no longer correlates with an output of growth, results, and progress. And surely, no more fulfillment. Stubbornly, our natural response is to pound the pavement harder until we realize we're worse off. We've arrived at the law of diminishing hustle, where every added input works against us. Every email, social media scroll, or sales call gets us further away from our desired outcome, and it costs us dearly. Like some of life's universal pleasures, including summer nights, naps, caffeine, Netflix, and my guilty pleasure, Taylor Swift, things can work until they don't. After days of slumber in bed, we become bored. Another dose of caffeine takes us from energized to paranoid. Watching 2 hours of our favorite show is fun. Binging for an entire week leaves us empty. Okay, Taylor never gets old. Hustle is no exception. We know work ethic matters. We understand delaying gratification for a better future is a psychological trigger for success. We get leaning into resistance instead of procrastinating pays off. But at this inflection point, more is not only less, performance falls off a cliff, and it takes our sanity with it. With the law of diminishing hustle, the right hustle at the right times leads to an optimal level of results until that very same hustle works against you. But there's a problem. This inflection point happens after you've reached your peak state of hustle. You're firing on all cylinders, which makes it brutally hard to identify. Hopped up on hustle's addictive qualities, you burn the midnight oil for another 3 hours. But you know the extra time was essentially worthless because it was spent on the other side of the inflection point. Consider research by Professor John Pincavel of Stanford, who aimed to find the sweet spot between hours worked and actual productivity. Finding more is not more, saying, productivity falls off a cliff after 55 hours in 1 week. Someone who puts in 70 hours produces nothing more with those extra 15 hours. Or a more extreme case from productivity expert Chris Bailey, who shared on the Resist Average Academy podcast that he accomplished nearly as much in 20-hour weeks as 90-hour weeks. Being drenched in hustle's dopamine is like having that fourth cocktail before dinner at happy hour. You're making grand declarations and hugging bartenders. You can't be trusted. Your friend has to concoct a random story about how you took the wrong medication as she hails you an Uber. Even when it's obvious we're on the other side of the inflection point, we talk ourselves into more doing. Stopping is for quitters, taking breaks is for the entitled. Let's see how this law works. Imagine a simple graph with hustling on the y-axis and results on the x-axis. There comes a point when more is not more, and we call this the point of diminishing returns. In other words, every time you add in more hustle, you start to get less results until it starts working all together. Think of your favorite food on the planet, the one you salivate simply thinking about, every last bite an orgasmic experience. I'm weird, but mine are acai bowls from a particular place in the Red Rocks of Sedona, Arizona. I have dreams about these connotations. They keep me up at night. They drive me wild. My fiance is concerned. After I have one, I realize I can't just have one. That would be crazy talk. The second one starts as amazing, and yet halfway through, it starts to lose its potency. It's still incredible, but wearing off. By the time I start the third bowl, I've got cramps, and this is no longer fun. If I keep going, my day is shot. Damn you, acai. Damn you. If it can happen with acai, trust me, it can happen with anything, including hustle. Like hustle, it has gone from mouth-watering to soul-crushing, from creative to destructive, from powerful to abysmal. So what happens after the point of diminishing returns? A series of consequences that suck the life force out of your peace, growth, and fulfillment, and oddly enough leads to less performance, specifically 8 consequences, which include, 1, it is never enough. 2, fulfillment escapes you. 3, you think money will solve all your problems. 4, work takes over your life. 5, success feels...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.